What's up, Ninja Nerds? In this video today, we're gonna be talking about acute myelogenous leukemia. Before we get started, if you guys actually like this video, it makes sense, it helps you, please support us. How can you do that? Hit that like button, comment down in the comment section, and please subscribe. Also, you guys want some awesome notes, illustrations, follow along with me during this lecture? Please go down in the description box below. We have a link to our website. Check all that stuff out. All right, let's talk about acute myelogenous leukemia. I commonly say AML a lot. It's a lot easier to say, but AML. Really, this disease is a problem with the hematopoiesis pathway. So hematopoiesis, the production of all blood cells, really, that's what it is. And it all starts with this beautiful cell right here. So this takes place in what's called the red bone marrow, right? So in this, it starts with this big head honcho called the hemocytoblast. So the hemocytoblast is like the stem cell for all blood cells. And what happens is it differentiates. And when it differentiates into two cell lines. One is called the lymphoid stem cell, and the other one is called the myeloid stem cell. The myeloid stem cell then actually differentiates into a couple different cell lines. One is it becomes a red blood cell, because it actually becomes what's called an erythroblast, which will become an erythrocyte. It also will become a platelet. And platelets, actually, what happens is the myeloid stem cell becomes a megakaryoblast and becomes a platelet. And the last thing is, this can become something called a myeloblast. So this is called a myeloblast. And what happens is myeloblast can then actually become something called a promyelocyte. And then it can differentiate into completely fully functional granulocytes. And there's three different types here. One, two, three. This is called a neutrophil. All right, very, very powerful cell. This one is called a eosinophil. And this last one here is called a basophil. And these three collectively, is called a specific group called granulocytes, okay? So these three here are called granulocytes. Now, just to quickly go over the rest of the hematopoiesis pathway, lymphoid stem cells actually do become something specific called a lymphoblast. This is not important to this lecture. When we start talking about something called ALL and CLL, it will become important. But these lymphoblasts actually do further differentiate and they become something called B lymphocytes. And the other one is called T lymphocytes. But here's really what's interesting. In a patient who has what's called AML or acute myelogenous leukemia, the problem is right here, going from the myoblast to the promyelocyte and then into these actual functional white blood cells. So you can't actually progress forward. So the myoblast continues to keep dividing and dividing and dividing without differentiating, and you get tons of these little suckers. And these things crowd out the bone marrow, get into the bloodstream, go all over to different tissues and cause tons and tons of problems. Now the question comes, what is the reason why the myeloblast can't actually differentiate into promyelocytes and then become functional white blood cells? Let's talk about that reason. So there's a couple different causes, and out of these, there's three particular ones that I want you to remember. One could be because, again, to recap, here is our hemocytoblast. So this is called our hemocytoblast. It'll become a lymphoid stem cell. Don't worry about this process now. We want to know that this becomes a myeloid stem cell, then this becomes red blood cells, platelets, or a myeloblast, and this is supposed to become promyelocytes, and then the granulocytes. Now the problem here is we want to know what is the reason why there's so many of these myeloblasts, because it's stuck in this state of constant division and can't differentiate into becoming these particular cell lines. Three particular reasons. One is maybe there was some type of DNA mutation. And if there was a DNA mutation, maybe it caused the cell to mutate in a particular way where it allowed the cell to continue to keep replicating without dying. Huh. How would I do that? One way that we could do this is called chemoradiation. So if someone has a history of chemoradiation therapy in their past, think about this. And the reason why is, imagine here, from the chemoradiation, here's some DNA. I hit that DNA with the chemoradiation and I cause a mutation. That mutation then causes this particular gene here. Maybe this gene allows for this cell to continue to keep replicating and dividing. So now there's a mutation. There's a mutation from this chemo radiation, and this mutation now allows for this cell to continue to keep replicating. So it allows for excessive DNA replication and cell division without the cell actually dying. It's able to evade apoptosis. That's one particular reason. The second one is it's usually some type of genetic abnormality. And there's two particular ones that I want you to remember. So genetic abnormalities, so genetic disease, if you will. The two that I want you to remember that have a high association, particularly with AML, one is called Down syndrome. And so Down syndrome, what are the particular genes, or apologize, the chromosomes that are really affected here? In Down syndrome, it's usually trisomy 21. So there's three particular chromosomes of 21. The 21 chromosome, there's three copies of it. So they call this trisomy 21. And these have a high risk of potentially be causing AML. But here's the really, really important one that I want you to remember. There's a subtype. So AML has a subtype, and this is really, really important. It's called APL, acute promyelocytic leukemia. Acute promyelocytic leukemia. And this one is due to what's called a 15-17 translocation. And this is important. I can't stress this enough. I actually want to highlight out this one. So this one is probably one of the more important causes to remember. Now, what happens here is, let's say here you have chromosome 15, here you have chromosome 17, and they start swapping some of this actual, their genes. When they do this, they form like a fusion gene. So they say here's a fusion gene as a result of them kind of swapping the chromosomes. And this fusion gene acts like this mutated gene up here. And this mutated gene allows for them to continue to keep replicating and replicating and replicating and replicating without the ability of dying. And this allows for the cell to continue to keep replicating without actually truly differentiating. This is a problem because this specific gene here is called the PMLRARA gene. So the PML retinoic acid receptor alpha gene. So these are really, really important things to remember, specifically 15-17 translocation and PMLRARA genes. There's one last cause. And this last one is usually due to some type of bone marrow disorder. And so there's a very specific type of bone marrow disorder, okay? So if someone has a underlying bone marrow disorder, this has the potential to progress to AML. And there's two particular types. One is called myelodysplastic syndrome. So myelodysplastic syndrome is a type of syndrome in which they don't have a lot of blast cells in comparison to acute myelocytic leukemia. And what happens is over time, this disease progresses, progresses, and progresses to where it can become AML. There's one other disease, we'll talk about this one in that video, but CML. CML over time can actually convert into AML. And so these are two big things that I want you guys to remember here, okay? So the reason why you can have tons and tons of myoblasts could be because you cause some type of mutation or fusion gene. It could be due to chemo radiation. It could be due to Down syndrome. Big type of chromosomal translocation is 15-17 with the PML, RARA gene, or it could be an underlying bone marrow disorder that has progressed to AML. Now let's talk about what are the consequences of having tons of these myoblasts in the bone marrow and in the blood and in the tissues. All right, so now we gotta move into the next part, which is, again, why are there so many of these myoblasts within the actual bone marrow? What was the reason why? Again, it could be due to some type of underlying chemo radiation causing mutations or a genetic abnormality that could lead to a kind of a fusion gene. What was the specific one? That was the PML, RARA gene, which was due to the 15-17 translocation seen in APL. Or there's some type of underlying bone marrow disease that's already present and it just progresses to AML, MDS, or CML. Now, in this situation, you got all these myoblasts just like replicating like bunnies in the bone marrow. They're taking up so much space in the bone marrow that it starts hogging nutrients for other kind of cell lines and starts occupying so much space that you aren't able to allow for replication of other cell lines to occur. So now, red blood cells start decreasing in number, platelets start decreasing in number, and you just got, you know, these tons and tons of myoblasts. So now the question then becomes, okay, what's the downstream effects? All right, so you have tons of myoblasts. The problem about having all these myoblasts is that they are not functional. They are decreased, they are not functional white blood cells. So you aren't allowing for these to actually become neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils. So they are not functional white blood cells. They don't have the ability to undergo phagocytosis or kill parasitic worms or trigger inflammatory reactions. And so because of that, you have a high risk of infections. So now the downstream consequences of this is that there's now a high risk of infections. And this is usually one of the ways that people die from this disease. This is a very high mortality effect. And what are some of the ways that they can actually end up having these infections? One is it can cause infection of the lungs. Pneumonia tends to be one of the more common ones. It can cause infection of particularly the bladder or the kidneys, and this can cause UTIs. Or it may affect the skin and cause cellulitis. So it may cause things like cellulitis or abscesses, things to that effect, and it can cause more infections. But that's one downstream negative consequences of this actual acute myelogenous leukemia, is high risk of infections. Now the other thing is that you're actually dropping down the number of red blood cells. So we call this anemia. Now anemia, whenever you have less red blood cells, you don't deliver oxygen to the tissues. And so because you don't deliver oxygen to the tissues, you need oxygen to be able to produce ATP. And so the energy productions actually start decreasing. So you become super fatigued. So that's one potential feature, is fatigue. The other one is that blood, right, if it's oxygenated, should have a good pallor to the, it should give, actually give a good hue to the skin, a good reddish, pinkish hue to the skin. But if you have less of that hemoglobin, less oxygenated hemoglobin, it doesn't give that nice kind of like reddish, pinkish hue to the skin, and so you actually start looking like you're pale. That's unfortunate. So pallor. And then also dyspnea. So dyspnea can be a feature with severe anemia though, okay? So these are potential features that may be suggestive of anemia. But you'd need to get a CBC to really confirm that. Now, the other thing is when you have low platelets, what is this called? Thrombocytopenia. And again, the question then becomes, why is there low levels of these lines? It's because, again, there's so many myeloblasts that are crowding out the bone marrow that there's not enough nutrients for the red blood cells, not enough nutrients for the platelets, and not enough space for them as well. When there's low levels of platelets, now that you have risk of bruising and bleeding, because these are supposed to like stop you, it's supposed to help to initiate clotting mechanisms. But if you don't have these, you can't initiate clotting mechanisms. So now you end up with bruising, so like little like blood leaking out of the capillaries into your skin. You end up with a lot of bruising, petechiae, purpura, ecchymosis, or you end up bleeding, epistaxis, gingival bleeding, full-on GI bleed. That's a terrible situation. So watch out for any evidence of bruising and bleeding. And again, the terms that they may throw on the actual exam is things like petechiae, purpura, ecchymosis, or full-on bleeding, like epistaxis, gingival bleeding, or GI bleeding. So watch out for these as potential features secondary to thrombocytopenia, but you need a CBC to confirm that. Okay, the next thing, this is actually interesting. So because the myoblasts are actually crowding out so much space, so again, the reason why this is less space is what I want you to think about. Less space is the reason why there's less platelets. But here's the other problem. You have so many of these myoblasts replicating like bunnies. What it does is, when you have tons of myoblasts, it actually starts to cause expansion of the bone marrow. So it expands the bone marrow, because you have to make space. And when you expand the bone marrow, it actually activates a lot of like nerves that are actually present and kind of innervating the bone marrow. And because of that, this can actually precipitate a bone pain. And this can look at a lot of different ways. This may present like back pain, this may present like actual like chest pain, kind of like a sternal pain, or it may actually present with them like limping. Right? So that's another potential way to think about that. So watch out for this as another potential feature. These are the big things that I really want you to think about due to the high amounts of myoblasts that are actually present within the bone marrow. Now, let's say that the myoblast to say, okay, I've had my time in the actual bone marrow, time for me to go out and start, you know, jacking things up in the bloodstream. So it starts leaking out of the bone marrow and into the bloodstream. And now look, you got these myoblasts just flooding through your bloodstream. They go out there and start kind of just causing tons and tons of problems. What kind of problems? Here's one. And this is usually an oncological emergency. Usually this is actually seen whenever the white blood cell or the myoblast amount is so high that it can actually literally clot off blood vessels. That's scary. So imagine there's a blood vessel supply in the brain, a blood vessel supply in the lungs, a blood vessel supply in the retina, and even technically the veins that actually drain the penis. These can be problematic areas. So whenever the actual myoblast number is greater than or equal to at least 100,000, they become so much that they actually start clogging up the actual blood vessels to particular areas of the body. And because of that, you start seeing downstream occlusive effects of hypoxemia. So if I'm not able to give If I'm blocking off blood flow, which is supposed to be going here and giving nutrients and giving things like oxygen, but I'm blocking that off, so I'm not giving these type of oxygen nutrients to the tissue, they can experience hypoxemia. This can look like a headache at first, but then it can progress to a TIA, or it can present to as a full-on ischemic stroke. That's terrifying. The other thing is it could block off blood flow to the lungs and potentially alter the gas exchange process. And this can present as first, maybe just as dyspnea, maybe they're a little bit short of breath. And then it can present as full-on hypoxemia to the point where it can actually cause acute respiratory failure, okay? And this could also block off the actual blood flow going to the retina, which may present as maybe vision changes, but that can fully go on to complete vision loss. So this is terrifying types of things that you want to be able to pick up. This is usually a result of leukostasis. Way more common, so you can see this in AML, and you can see this in ALL, but it is way more common in AML. Now the next one, this is also a really bad one. This is called tumor lysis syndrome. Now we'll talk about it a little bit more in the treatment section, but tumor lysis syndrome can occur under two particular circumstances. So tumor lysis syndrome. One reason is it's because a patient has a crazy high tumor burden, and it can happen spontaneously. It's just not as common. So we'll put here the two particular situations. One is the most common reason, and the second one is the less common reason. The most common reason is a secondary to chemotherapy. So someone received chemotherapy and just ruptured open a ton of these actual tumor cells, the leukemic cells. The other one, which is less common, is actually spontaneous due to high tumor burdens, and it's usually secondary to high tumor burdens. It's just not as common. And so what I really want you to associate tumor lysis syndrome with is it's usually a result of treatment of the leukemia. Okay, so that's why we'll get into a little bit more in treatment. But what happens is, if it were to happen spontaneously, and the reason why is you'd have to have like a very, very, very high number of these myeloblasts. They would have to be very, very high to the point where they're getting stuck in blood vessels, like in leukostasis, to actually pop open. If this happens, what they do is they start spilling out tons of intracellular contents, such as what? Such as potassium, such as phosphates, such as uric acid. And what is the problem with this? The problem is that these can really cause harm to the kidneys. These can really do a lot of damage to your poor old kidneys. And what happens is the uric acid is actually nephrotoxic. What it can do is it can actually form these things called like urate crystals. So it can actually form something called crystals. They're actually called like a crystal-induced nephropathy. So it can cause things like these little crystals to form. And these can get deposited into the actual nephron and cause damage to the actual kidney tubules and affect the ability to reabsorb and secrete substances. The other thing is that phosphates can combine with calcium. And when calcium combines with the phosphates, these also form like calcium phosphate crystals, like kidney stones. And again, they deposit and cause a lot of damage to the kidney tubules. And eventually this will precipitate an acute kidney injury, which can look like a patient has low urine output, or they may present with a high creatinine or a high BUN. And so these are things to think about, okay? And again, problem is usually due to, this one is the worst case scenario, the uric acid, but it can also be due to the phosphates. And then having tons and tons of potassium in the bloodstream is not a very good thing as well, because this can cause cardiac arrhythmias. Okay, so we got leukostasis, tumor lysis syndrome. What else? These can cause a lot of cutaneous manifestations. So cutaneous and like mucosal manifestations. So cutaneous and mucosal effects. And so imagine they deposit into the skin, like into your actual like skin here tissue. What that can do is that can cause something called leukemia cutis. So one thing it can do is it can cause leukemia cutis. And you know what that looks like? Take a look at this. It actually is pretty cool to see. That's actually a terrible situation, but leukemia cutis, it's a very interesting picture. So take a look at that. Now, we see leukemia cutis as one. Another one is it could actually deposit into the mucosa of the gingiva. And this can cause something called gingival hyperplasia. Gingival hyperplasia. So that's another potential thing to look out for. So these are big ones. Leukemia cutis is one cutaneous manifestation, and the other one is gingival hyperplasia. And let's actually take a look at what this looks like. The last effect and probably the most fearful and downstream negative consequences of acute myelogenous leukemia is something called DIC. DIC is terrifying, and especially in this particular disease. So imagine here, I have a myeloblast. Here's my myeloblast. And this is usually only seen in a very specific type, so I actually have to highlight this. This is DIC only seen in APL. Go back, remind yourself, what was APL particularly? 15-17 translocation with a PML RARA gene. If that happens, this is the only particular type of AML subtype that you can see DIC in. Now, what happens is these myeloblasts release two particular types of problems. One is they can release something called tissue factor. And you guys know tissue factor from the clotting pathway. This is actually factor 3. So it activates the extrinsic pathway and leads to increased clotting. And then when you have increased clotting, you actually decrease your clotting factors because you cause so much clotting to occur that you consume so many of your clotting factors. So it increases the clotting pathway, but then over time, decreases the amount of clotting factors that you have present. So if you have decreased number of clotting factors, now you can't actually clot when you need to clot. That's a terrifying situation. The other problem here is that it releases something called TPA. So it has a particular enzyme on its actual surface called TPA. And what happens is TPA can actually cause lots of fibrinolysis. It can break down fibrinogen and fibrin strands, and so now you actually don't have the ability to keep a clot stable, and you actually can't form a clot as well. That's terrifying as well. So now there's tons of fibrinolysis. And so that also has decreased ability to clot. And so because of that, you have a very, very high bleeding risk because you're causing tons of fibrinolysis via this particular molecule, and you're causing lots of clotting factors to be consumed. So this is decreased clotting factors secondary to consumption. That's important to remember, secondary to consumption, because you're just going and chewing through them. Now you have an increased bleeding risk. So the problem is, in this disease, is they make too much of this, and they have a high bleeding risk. And where do they bleed? They bleed into the brain. This is probably the highest mortality effect. Or into the lungs. And they can also bleed into the cutaneous tissues as well. So I'd say the worrisome finding would be an intracerebral hemorrhage. Second one would be a pulmonary hemorrhage. And then, you know, the one that you'd be thankful to actually have, even though it's terrible, would be like any kind of bruising or bleeding. Potentially, maybe they have like an IV in, and they're bleeding from their IV sites, or they're oozing from a lot of different areas. That's a big, big thing to watch out for. So these are the complications and things that you have to watch out for, my friends, in patients who have AML. Now what we have to do is go talk about how do we diagnose it. All right, my friends, so now we have a very strong suspicion that a patient may have acute myelogenous leukemia. We started off by saying, oh, they had some history of chemo radiation. Oh, they have a history of MDS or CML. Oh, okay, maybe they have like an unfortunate Down syndrome, right? That could be a potential possibility. But that's potentially the causes of it. Then they end up with features of high myeloblasts within the bone marrow. Maybe they end up with kind of like fatigue, dyspnea, pallor. Maybe they end up with bone pain. Maybe they end up with a lot of bruising and bleeding, high risk of infections. They have a lot of infections that are unfortunate for them and aren't easily explained. They also have a lot of other features such as leukemia cutis or gingival hyperplasia. They have other things like leukostasis and DIC and tumor lysis syndrome features. If those are possible, you should start working them up for AML. So, first thing is a CBC with peripheral blood smear. That's a good kind of screening test. And the reason why is it kind of confirms or supports the things that we actually talked about in the pathophys. So for example, because these myoblasts are crowding out the bone marrow, what would happen to the red blood cell line? It would drop, right? So we would see features of low red blood cells. That's one feature. We would see low levels of platelets. And we would potentially see what for the white blood cells? These can be variable, believe it or not. So that's the weird thing for the white blood cells. For the actual true neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, all those particular cells, the variability of the white blood cells is what's very, very interesting in this disease. So it literally could be high and they could have leukocytosis, or it could be low and they could have leukopenia. So it's not a true, reliable diagnostic marker. But the low red blood cells and the low platelets, secondary to decreased space because of all those myeloblasts crowding out the bone marrow, does support the actual features that we talked about. And then we need to see lots of myeloblasts. So having infections, yes, you could prove pneumonia, but there's a lot of other reasons people can have pneumonia. We actually want to see the actual myeloblasts. And so what we actually want to do is we actually want to take, okay, Lots of these myoblasts, we know that they can cause potential infections because they're not functional, but what if I see them on a smear, a peripheral blood smear? They won't look like normal neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils, all those. So they'll look weird, they'll look not differentiated. And so that would be a potential sign. So what I do is I do a peripheral blood smear, and on that you'll see tons of these myeloblasts. There'll be just a plethora of these puppies. And that would be enough to support high myoblasts, low platelets, low red blood cells. Boom, that's right there, that's our first step. If we have these present, right? So if I see low red blood cells supporting anemia, low platelets supporting thrombocytopenia, and I see lots of myoblasts on my peripheral blood smear, already I have a very strong differential, a very strong suggestion of AML. Then what I can do is I can actually confirm it. So once I've done this test, I'm going to do a confirmation or a definitive, so this would be our definitive diagnosis. This would definitely tell us if a patient has AML. So what I'll do is I'll do a bone marrow biopsy. I'll take a piece of the actual bone marrow, and what I should see is I should see a ton of these myoblasts within the bone marrow. So much of them. Less red blood cells, less platelets, variable numbers of white blood cells, differentiated white blood cells, but I'm gonna see tons of these myoblasts. And we say that if there's actually at least greater than 20% of these myoblasts within the bone marrow, this is pretty much diagnostic for leukemia, especially acute myelogenous leukemia. The other thing that you may see is that when you look at this on a peripheral blood smear, or you look at this underneath a bone marrow biopsy and you actually take a look at it, you may be able to see these kind of like little pink things here. These are called our rods. These are called our rods. And our rods are very suggestive of AML, but they're more suggestive of APL, which is the subtype of AML. It's actually just kind of like a polymerized crystallization of what's called myeloperoxidase enzymes, okay? So you may see our rods here, or you may see our rods here. And this is, again, very suggestive of AML with this specific subtype called APL. CBC with peripheral blood smear supported the reason we would have acute leukemia. Bone marrow biopsy definitively diagnoses and confirms acute myelogenous leukemia. But then the next steps are really determining prognostication and treatment. In other words, they determine if a patient has a very specific subtype of AML. What was that one that I keep stressing on nonstop? APL. That's what I want to know. The first test that we can do is something called immunophenotyping. These aren't as helpful as the genetic studies in this disease, but what they'll look for is they'll support, again, the reason of AML. And so immunophenotyping, we would have a very specific protein that would be positive. You see this kind of like thing right here? This is called myeloperoxidase. And if the myeloperoxidase enzyme is positive or present, this is supportive of AML. That's very supportive of AML because there's another molecule that's actually seen particularly only in ALL, and that's called TDT. So it would be TDT negative in AML and MPO positive in AML. That's really important. Flow cytometry is not helpful. So I'm just gonna put that it's not applicable. It actually doesn't provide any truly clinical useful information. It's way more helpful in ALL. Okay, so we'll talk about that when we get into ALL. Let's move on to genetic studies though. Genetic studies are actually very helpful. And so what we can do here is, I can take the nuclear material from this myoblast, and I can look at the actual chromosomes, and I could try to find where is there an abnormal chromosome. So I could do like a karyotyping basically, and what I'll look and I'll see is like, oh shoot, look, there's this weird like swapping of genetic material on chromosomes 15 and 17. There's this weird translocation present. If this is present, this is suggestive of APL. This is really important. You want to know why? APL, which is a subtype of AML, is a completely different treatment regimen. That's why I need to know this. So the purpose of genetic studies is not necessarily to diagnose AML, it's to find the specific subtype of AML, which determines what type of treatments we will institute. Okay? So this is really, really important. If I do this genetic studies, when I do cytogenetics, and I find a chromosomal translocation, 15-17, it's suggestive of APL. That's important. The next thing is I can do like a PCR, and what I can do is I can take and say, okay, here's my 15-17 translocation that I have, I'm gonna take the particular fusion gene and I'm gonna look, oh, here's my fusion gene right here. My fusion gene, if I go out and I actually PCR and I actually try to find the specific gene, if it comes back positive for PML, retinoic acid receptor alpha gene, it's positive for this. This is highly suggestive of APL. And again, that's important because if I find this, my friends, this is gonna determine a completely different type of treatment regimen that I would do for APL in comparison to all other subtypes of AML. Okay, CBC with peripheral blood smear to start off the diagnosis of acute myelogenous leukemia, bone marrow biopsy to confirm, immunohistochemistry would give us potentially the MPO positive suggestive AML, flow cytometry not super helpful in this one, better for ALL, and then genetic studies confirming the subtype of AML called APL, and which is important for treatment processes. You can also test for some of the complications that we talked about. Leukostasis, not as much. That would be a little bit more of a clinical diagnosis. Tumor lysis syndrome you actually can test for. And so what you're looking for is you're looking for all the evidence of those particular molecules that ruptured out of the cells to be present. And so we actually, the way I remember this is puke. I know it sounds really weird, but the cells are puking out their intracellular contents. So there's gonna be high levels of phosphates. There'll be high levels of uric acid. There'll be, so then you get to the puke part, right? You got K. You also have high levels of potassium. So then you get to this weird one, which is the, okay, we got the puke part. You can actually remember that their calcium is low. Okay, so the calcium should be low. And the reason why the calcium is low is because it's complexing with the phosphates. But if you guys remember, what was the downstream negativity of the high uric acid and the calcium phosphates? They form crystals. And these potential crystals that you can get plus this plus the calcium, they can make these crystals. And these crystals are the problem because they go and they get stuck where? They get stuck, son of a gun. They get stuck in the kidneys. And when they get stuck in the kidneys, they cause a lot of acute kidney injury. And when they cause this acute kidney injury, this may be evidenced by what? A very high creatinine or a very high BUN. So these may be other things to think about, is potentially getting a electrolyte panel, getting all of these electrolytes tested, and also testing for any kinds of evidence of acute kidney injury. The other thing is the DIC. This is another scary one. Leukemia cutis and the gingival hyperplasia, those are visibly evident. But the DIC is another one that we have to be able to find. And generally what we look at is the coagulation parameters. So we look at things like the PTT, we look at things like the INR, we look at things like fibrinogen, we look at things like D-dimer, we look at things like platelets, and we look at things like your red blood cells. And this will kind of give us a good idea if a patient is in DIC. And so what you'll see is that they're very bleedy. And so because of that, usually whenever they have a high risk of bleeding, the PTT and the INR will be elevated. The fibrinogen, which was getting destroyed by the TPA, is gonna be in the dump. The D-dimer, which is evidence of these fibrin degradation products, if there's lots of fibrinolysis, D-dimer always goes up. And then platelets will also be getting consumed, red blood cells will be getting consumed and also broken apart. So these are the problems with this particular disease, and this will help you to assess for DIC. So this will be for tumor lysis syndrome. This will be for DIC. And again, leukemia cutis and the gingival hyperplasia is a physical examination finding, and leukostasis is technically a clinical examination finding as well, or a clinical finding as well. All right, guys, so now we're gonna talk about treatment of AML. Now, when we have a patient who has AML, the first thing that you have to remember is this is a disease that's primarily treated with chemotherapy, okay? So that's the primary thing that we're gonna talk about. So first thing is, let's talk about AML specifically, so the treatment of AML, but specifically the non-APL subtype. In this particular phenotype of AML, the primary treatment is going to be chemotherapy. All right, so that's what I want you to remember. Chemotherapy is going to be the primary treatment process for these particular patients. And the way we do chemotherapy for this patient population who has AML of the non-APL subtype is we do it in a very specific way. You actually do what's called induction chemotherapy. Then you do what's called consolidation chemotherapy for a certain amount of time. And then you do what's called maintenance chemotherapy with the goal of being complete remission. That's obviously the goal. Now the question probably comes is what are the agents that are used to treat AML? What are the chemotherapeutic agents? And there's two preferable agents that are utilized. One is called what's called cytarabine. So cytarabine is one particular agent. And the other one is called idarubicin, or its sister, daunorubicin. So you can do what's called ida or daunorubicin. These are the two particular options of chemotherapeutic agents that you would utilize for induction, consolidation, and potentially maintenance chemotherapy, with the goal being, hopefully, complete remission. All right? That's the goal. Now, if for some particular reason, there's a very specific type, okay? So now we're gonna talk about this next one here, which is called APL. So we're gonna talk about the specific kind of like chemotherapeutic regimen that you can utilize in patients who have APL. So we're gonna talk about the chemotherapy, particularly in another specific type, which is going to be the AML with the APL subtype. In this particular population, all right, this is a completely different treatment regimen. So we use cytarabine, idarubicin, or daunorubicin for patients who have the AML subtype, who have AML without, not the APL subtype. And we'll do induction chemotherapy, consolidation chemotherapy, maintenance chemotherapy with the goal of complete remission. For this one, this actually has a very favorable prognosis. And so for this one, we actually don't do this induction and consolidation and maintenance therapy. We actually can use something, and what we're trying to do is, the goal here is to promote differentiation. So you're literally trying to take these myeloblasts, differentiate them into promyelocytes, and differentiate them into white blood cells. Like literally like turn them back into neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils. That's what you're trying to do. So you're trying to literally take them to go from a myeloblast, this is literally what you're trying to do. You're going to give them something that caused them to go from a myeloblast to a promyelocyte to a granulocyte. That is literally the goal here. And that might sound super weird because you're like, why can't we do that with these? This is one of the rare types of diseases that we can actually do this one. And so that's what we want to do. We actually want to try to stimulate this process to promote differentiation. Now the problem with this can produce a really rare situation called differentiation syndrome. We're not going to talk about that. It's beyond the scope of this lecture. But the agents that we use to promote differentiation here are very cool. So one is called all-trans-retinoic acid. That's the first one. This is high yield, I can't stress this enough. And then generally the add-on is what's called arsenic. You're like, arsenic? That sounds freaking terrible. It's not good, obviously, but these are the two preferable agents to give to these patients. And what you're trying to do with all-trans-retinoic acid and arsenic trioxide is you are trying to promote this particular process. To be able to get rid of the myeloblasts, because you got tons of myeloblasts, start shunting them over to making granulocytes. Because now you have functional white blood cells. And you don't have a lot of these myeloblasts crowding out the bone marrow and causing all these complications. Pretty cool, right? If they do, you can make massive amounts of granulocytes. This can produce something called differentiation syndrome, where they have this massive cytokine storm, and it can cause high mortality. So usually with that situation, we may add on steroids to this particular treatment regimen. All right, so this is the two chemotherapeutic options. The options that then next come is we can consider something called a bone marrow transplant. And generally with a bone marrow transplant, this could be AML that's undergone. So this is usually someone who has AML, and they have potentially two particular situations. They have AML with a very, very poor prognostic type of AML. So there's an AML with a poor prognostic findings. So whenever we did the genetic studies, if we found a very poor prognostic genetic mutation that was causing AML, they're likely going to require a bone marrow transplant because they're likely going to fail chemotherapy. Or if they have AML and they failed chemotherapy. So they did not undergo complete remission from the induction, consolidation, and maintenance therapy, then we would go to a bone marrow transplant. Essentially what you're trying to do is create another hemocytoblast. That's what you're trying to do. You're trying to give them a hemocytoblast that will kind of be a better hemocytoblast and turn into proper myelostem cells, proper myeloblasts, and all the other types of white blood cells. So you're trying to give them a bone stem cell that literally will actually take over and help them to produce functional white blood cells, red blood cells, all the other cell lines. The next situation that I want you guys to think about with AML is the treatment of complications. And this is really what was the big one. So management of complications is the last thing that I want to talk about. DIC, that's, I think that's kind of a little bit beyond this lecture. It's specifically associated with APL. So obviously treating APL with all trans retinoic acid and arsenic trioxide is of most importance. But the two particular complications that I need you guys to be aware of here is going to be leukostasis. So leukostasis, which is very high association with AML. I want you guys to think about leukostasis way more with AML than ALL. And the other one is called tumor lysis syndrome. And again, what is this commonly associated with? It's commonly associated with the chemotherapy. You can have it spontaneously, but not as common. Leukostasis with the features of having more than 100,000 white blood cells, or myeloblasts technically, clogging up the arteries of the brain, clogging up the arteries of the lungs, clogging up the arteries of the penis, technically the veins of the penis, and clogging up the arteries of the retinal artery, causing things like headaches, TIA, CVAs, dyspnea, hypoxemia, acute respiratory failure, causing blurry vision or vision loss, and then potentially priapism, the problem where the venous drains aren't properly draining things properly. But in this situation, there's too many white blood cells. So in this situation, you need to do something called cytoreduction. So when this happens, whenever a patient has leukostasis, the big goal is cytoreduction, and you have to do this quickly. And the two ways that we can do this is one, is you can start off with what's called hydroxyurea. And what hydroxyurea will do is it'll kind of like just knock down these actual myoblasts from continuously proliferating. So it'll knock down the number of myoblasts. And then the other thing is we can actually suck some of those myoblasts out of the bloodstream. So if we get rid of the ton of these myoblasts, they won't clog up these blood vessels. So get rid of tons and tons of myoblasts. How do we do that? We call this leukapheresis. So leukapheresis. And this is technically gonna be the best, this is, I'd say, the big high yield thing to take away. So this is the big one that I want you to remember. Okay, so leukapheresis would be the way that we would help to be able to rip off all of these myoblasts, and we would use hydroxyurea to also kind of shut down and knock down some of those myoblasts. And then what we would do is we would transition, and this is a strong indication for transitioning these patients into chemotherapy, which we talked about above, which would be the ida or daunorubicin plus cytarabine. The other thing is tumor lysis syndrome. What did we say was the problem with tumor lysis syndrome? The problem with tumor lysis syndrome is the high uric acid. So remember what I want you to remember here is here's a cell, here's a myoblast. It ruptures out and spills out uric acid. Now the problem is actually, let's go back a second, because what does uric acid come from? That's really the next important thing. Uric acid comes from something called purines. Oh. So it actually, it spills out something called purines. Purines then get converted into what's called uric acid. And uric acid is the thing that causes kidney damage. So what I can do is, when I have a patient with tumor lysis syndrome, it's really kind of avoiding the uric acids, because that uric acid is what causes it to get kind of go over here to the kidneys and cause nephrotoxicity. So it's really this uric acid molecule that's getting deposited into the kidneys that's causing acute kidney injury. The whole goal of treating tumor lysis syndrome is trying to avoid acute kidney injury. So what I can do is I can give one drug, and this drug is going to inhibit the conversion of purines into uric acid. This drug is called allopurinol. So that's one drug I can give. The second thing is, what if a lot of these purines that I spilled out already got converted into uric acid? Allopurinol will help to stop it if it hasn't converted yet, but what if I already have a lot of uric acid that's already been formed already? And allopurinol is not going to be as effective. Well, I'm going to end up with acute kidney injury. So how do I avoid this? I make him less toxic. So I convert him into something called allantoin. And allantoin is, this is toxic, this is nephrotoxic, this is not toxic to the kidneys. So the question is, how do I give a drug that helps to stimulate this pathway? This is called rasburicase. This is called rasburicase. So rasburicase will help to be able to convert uric acid into allantoin. So I end up with less uric acid and less risk of acute kidney injury. Pretty cool, right? So that's the ways that I would do this, allopurinol and rasburicase. And then also keep these things flushing through the kidneys. So keep them properly hydrated so that the crystals don't have time to be able to precipitate. And so the other thing that I can do here is I can do allopurinol, I can do rasburicase, and the other thing that I should give is to keep them kidneys continuously flushing out those crystals, IV fluids. So IV fluids would also be preferable as well. Other things that you could do is, again, you can also bind up some of the phosphates we said. You can give things like sevelamer. You can also give things that can actually help to avoid the potassium kind of rising. So you can give things like insulin, D50. You can also give things like albuterol treatment and things of that effect. But I think this is the more important thing to take away from treating tumor lysis syndrome is keeping the kidneys can properly hydrated and flushing out the crystals and avoiding crystal formation. All right, my friends, in this video, we talk about acute myelogenous leukemia, or AML. I hope it made sense. I hope that you guys enjoyed it. And as always, until next time.